Hello all, and welcome to Stingray Tom's Florida and another deeper dive into the archive. Before air conditioning, Augusts were miserable in Miami. Joseph Dumond had stopped by his local feed store in the Homestead area south of Miami. As usual, the day was hot, humid, and the air was filled with mosquitoes. It was 1934, and Dumond and his wife Grace had established one of the area's first tourist attractions the year before. Miami was easily the fastest growing area in the country, growing in the previous 20 years by 2,200%, and the Dumond's Monkey Jungle, located in the still rural southern part of the county, was immediately popular. This particular day, Joe Dumond was in a foul mood since he had been nursing a sick monkey the night before and was suffering in the miserable August weather. The owner of the feed store, Franz Scher, was a popular, gregarious local who chatted as easily as did the macaws and parakeets he kept in the store. This day, he was once again making suggestions on how Dumond could improve his new attraction. Add more trails, add more trees, get the people closer to the monkeys. But Dumond was weary and irritated by the repeated suggestions. His exasperation grew until he hit the counter with his hand and cried, "Franz, why don't you go and start your own damn jungle?" Looking around the store, Cher's eyes focused on his small collection of birds. "All right, I will, and it'll be a parrot jungle." It was not a great time to begin a new business, however. It was in the midst of the Great Depression, and the Chers were barely making do on the income from the feed store. There wasn't any money to buy land, and no money to hire workers to create the jungle. Still, Franz Scher, an unlikely person to create a tourist attraction, knew it's something that he should try. Proceeding with little money, but with a lot of work, the Scher family was able to open the attraction in 1936 with a couple dozen birds and a garden that was largely comprised of the plants and trees that had been on the property. Creating a simple Florida attraction was pretty much how it was done in the first half of the 20th century. While attractions created beforehand proved that the concept would be successful, there wasn't a lot of tourist money to go around, so it was always a risk. Parrot Jungle succeeded, where many others failed. Franz Scher's dream of a Parrot Jungle, officially named Parrot Jungle, would operate for 52 years under his and his family's ownership. For much of that time, it was one of Florida's premier attractions, entertaining and educating some 15 million visitors. So let's take a look at Parrot Jungle. A zoo and a garden, which had about 30-some species of birds, mostly parrots, and their relatives. It doesn't sound like much of an attraction, yet it made a huge impact on the state and the state of tourism.
I first learned of the conversation between Scher and Dumond on a visit to Parrot Jungle in the 80s. Chatting with an employee in the gift shop, I wondered aloud about the coincidence of three early Miami-area attractions named Orchid Jungle, Monkey Jungle, and Parrot Jungle. While the word jungle evokes the exotic and is rather appropriate in Miami, I wondered if there might have been a story behind the names. Orchid Jungle opened in 1923. Monkey Jungle was established a decade later, with Parrot Jungle following 3 years later. The attractions lie 18 miles or 29 kilometers apart between South Miami and Homestead. In the 1920s, everybody in that small farming community knew each other, and Scher visited the other jungles many times to get ideas. The story is verified by this souvenir booklet of Parrot Jungle, which dates to 1970 and is in the archive. Surprisingly, Parrot Jungle's history begins in Austria. Scher was born in the town of Hirschig in Austria's Alpine region in 1890. At the age of 14, he began a carpenter apprenticeship. He eventually emigrated to the U.S. in 1913 and worked as a carpenter. During World War I, he served in the U.S. Army. Being an Austrian citizen, he wasn't allowed to fight in Europe and instead served in North Carolina. After the war, he lived in Chicago, where he would meet Louise Kumpel. The two married the next year, and they would move to Homestead in 1925. Their feed and supply store is where France developed the idea of Parrot Jungle. For a decade, France would work as a carpenter and store owner. Louise worked at the store while raising the family. The shares were successful, at least until the Great Depression hit. But even after, the store and carpentry continued to provide the family's basic needs. Alongside his work, Franz would endeavor to learn more about the natural world surrounding him. Florida was a world of plants and animals radically different than Austria. Plus, he would discover his eventual interests in parrots and the other exotic birds. This was essentially accidental. His first bird, a blue and gold macaw named Zebra, was received in exchange for a delivery of fertilizer. Studying hard-to-find books and relying on the staff of the U.S. Department of Agriculture's Subtropical Horticultural Research Station, Franz would learn to identify and care for dozens of plants and trees. He learned to distinguish between all the parrot, parakeet, macaw, cockatoo, cockatiel, lory, lorikeet, and lovebird, as well as other birds such as flamingo, pheasant, and peafowl, what their needs and behaviors were, as well as their temperaments. So while on the face of it, Franz Scher looked to be an unlikely person to create a tropical garden and bird zoo, he'd done his homework, was a successful business owner, and a skilled carpenter. Really, the main issue was the size and scope of the project, but time and time again, Floridians developed attractions that were distinct, fascinating, and innovative, whether it was Turner's Sunken Gardens, Perry's Weeki Wachee, Ross Allen's Reptile Institute, Santini's Porpoise Schools, or Dumont's Monkey Jungle. In reality, it's not known how long Scher had been thinking of the idea. Joe Dumont might not have provided the inspiration, but it could have been the nudge that put the hardworking Scher in motion. He spent hours at Monkey Jungle and Orchid Jungle and began looking for the right property on which to build his idea. In a coincidence that sounds as if it could only happen in Florida, he found his location, 20 acres of overgrown dense hardwood hammock that had been a nudist colony. Due to local outrage, the nudists were evicted by the landlords. Located at the corner of Red Road and Killian Drive, Scher rented the site for $25 a month. The landowners were dubious of his plans, and not without reason. So was his wife when he told her the idea of an attraction where dozens of birds would fly free. Louise's response? They'll fly away. Undaunted, the enthusiastic feed store owner pressed on. He now had a lot of work to do. One thing was for certain. He knew that he'd have to carve pathways through the jungle-like foliage. Scher would have to create a lot of paths to keep visitors occupied with interesting sights to see. He worked almost by himself, since Louise ran the feed store, but on Sundays she and the kids would come to help. To be clear, the kids didn't like trading their free time with hard work, but they accepted their fate, especially since Dad was working as hard as he ever had. The additional help wasn't enough, so the Schers mortgaged their home. The cash was used to hire a backhoe and bulldozer. They filled the swampy areas, created ponds, and leveled paths. If you look at Florida's many botanical gardens, you might notice that most of their paths are curved this way and that. This curving nature accomplishes three goals. The first is that it provides a sense of intimacy for the visitors. Families would be somewhat hidden from others. Secondly, it gave people a feeling of discovery, always finding out what was around the bend. Finally, it makes the grounds feel larger, as the paths can meander past each other, hidden with jungle growth. While Scher might have come up with this concept on his own, it could have been partly suggested by the contours of the land itself. McKee Jungle Gardens in Vero Beach and Sunken Gardens in St. Pete both slightly predate Parrot Jungle and have similar pathways, as I've been showing. This is also the approach that many Florida gardens tended to have in the early 20th century. Formal gardens, like these at Vizcaya in Miami and the Ringling Estates in Sarasota, are the counterpoint. They have ordered and symmetrical plans and represent the designer's inclinations to recreate the formal gardens of European royalty. They're generally a representation of humankind's control over nature and, not surprisingly, were built for some of the wealthiest Americans. But Florida, with its thriving tropical and semi-tropical climates, suggested a less formal approach to many of its working-class entrepreneurs. Exploring the jungle would become one of the highlights of most Florida visitors. Even Disney World has its jungle cruise and the winding paths of Animal Kingdom. I've explored many of Florida's botanical gardens in this video, but back to Cher in his jungle. While the construction of the jungle was evolving, Cher was working on the bird part. He had a stock of lovebirds and parakeets which were received in trade for purchases at the store. The fall of 1936 saw parrots arrive from Texas, though they were originally wild birds from Central America. Also arriving were exotic pigeon, peafowl, and pheasant. The star of the show would be Cher's longtime companion zebra, the blue and gold macaw, since he was the only one with which France was used to working.
Opening on Sunday, December 20th, 1936, there were a handful of curious visitors standing outside before opening time. Cher, decked out in a safari jacket and pith helmet, one of the official uniforms of Florida tourism, welcomed them in, took their 25 cents, and led them on the first tour. There simply weren't enough birds at the time to make the impact Cher wanted, so Louise and the kids would grab parrots and macaws at the start of the tour and take them a back way to place them where the visitors would see them a second time. They'd return the birds to the start for the next tour.
That first day saw 100 visitors, enough to pay for 1 month's rent. Beyond the birds, the small zoo had an alligator, raccoon, koi fish, a skunk, and a small monkey named Susie. They had a pond in the front with hundreds of hatchling alligators, which they sold for 25 cents each. They had a snack bar and gift shop, and with all this, Cher realized that his dream might be coming true. One thing still needed to happen, however. While there weren't any cages for the larger birds, their wings had been clipped so they couldn't fly away. But Cher wanted them to be able to fly. He wanted his visitors to experience the exhilarating sight of parrots, macaws, and cockatoos flying from tree to tree and dropping down to land on their outstretched arms. Once the attraction opened its doors, Cher began working with his birds. While their feathers were clipped, he gave them all the fruits and nuts they wanted, and he lavished them with attention. He figured they'd get so spoiled with the living conditions that they wouldn't leave, or if they did, they'd come back. It took quite a while, but eventually things worked themselves out. They spent a lot of time driving around the area looking for wayward friends, and over the years, when South Miamians found an exotic bird in their backyard, they knew who to call. It wasn't long before Parrot Jungle's advertising included the phrase, "Beautiful, graceful birds fly free."
While I could go on to document the next few decades of Parrot Jungle's growth and its great success, I'd rather take a close look at two important matters regarding the attraction. Then I'll get back to a bit more of the general history. The first matter is an event that vaulted Parrot Jungle into the national news at the end of World War II. The second matter examines how the Chers influenced parrot breeding in the U.S. Maybe not the most exciting subject, but it's important to look at the many ways Florida's tourist attractions affected diverse aspects of American culture. There are other examples, such as how Ross Allen and Silver Springs worked with the federal government during World War II to develop antivenom to protect soldiers fighting in the South Pacific, and how Dick Pope of Cypress Gardens brought the sport of water skiing to national attention.
So let's move to 1946. Parrot Jungle's first decade was rough, but it was rough for all of America, as it included the Great Depression and a massive war. But still, the Chers weathered both storms, partly because France was hired as a construction foreman in Tennessee for the second half of the war. His income kept the family afloat and Parrot Jungle in the black. On September 2, 1945, Japan signed the papers of surrender, ending the war. Just 13 days later, a hurricane hit the homestead area. Although the Saffir-Simpson hurricane scale wouldn't be developed until 1971, it's estimated to have been a Category 4, and it nearly destroyed Homestead. While there was flooding at Parrot Jungle, it survived with little damage. Franz had built strong buildings, the jungle itself was well acquainted with storms, and while the birds were soaking wet, they survived. The big result was that Franz immediately returned from Tennessee. As 1945 turned to 46, the Shares restored the park and were starting to have a great winter season. While there were many visitors, there was one guest who stood out from the others. Winston Churchill, who had been the British Prime Minister from 1940 to 45 and would be again from 51 to 55, took a post-war trip to the U.S. He and his wife Clementine traveled along with 12,000 returning Canadian troops on RMS Queen Elizabeth, which, unlike in this postcard, was still in its wartime livery of battleship gray. They would spend 3 months in the U.S., and in February they arrived in Florida where they met up with their daughter, Sarah Oliver. The Churchills stayed at the home of Frank Clark, a Canadian wood pulp magnate who'd hosted Churchill at Lake of the Woods after the 1943 Quebec Conference, where he met with U.S. President Roosevelt and Canadian Prime Minister King. While in Miami Beach, Churchill, who liked animals, especially birds, quietly dropped by Parrot Jungle for a visit. Franz gave him the VIP tour, introducing the former Prime Minister to each of the birds. It's clear Churchill enjoyed the visit, and he was impressed with the attraction, because the next day he returned with Clementine. While spending a few more hours surrounded by hundreds of birds, they shared their own bird story. Earlier in their trip, they were presented with a turkey by the Texas Turkey Growers Association. While the bird was meant to be eaten, the Churchills didn't have the heart to dispatch it, and it had taken up residence in exclusive Miami Beach. Named Winnie, it had even laid several eggs. Churchill said it was impossible to take her back to Britain, and she wasn't exactly welcome in Miami Beach. He suggested the bird be boarded at Parrot Jungle. He pressed a $20 bill into Franz's hand and said it'd be Winnie's legacy. Cher was happy to adopt the turkey, and Parrot Jungle got yet another bird. When Cher went to Miami Beach to collect Winnie, he brought a few of his own birds along. It's not clear who invited the photographer to the gathering, but the event was duly documented, and the photos would be picked up by the wire services and published in many newspapers around the country. In an instant, Parrot Jungle got a magnitude of publicity that's impossible to buy. Churchill was the most famous and respected Englishman, and here he was, posing with birds from a Miami attraction. With a photo, Parrot Jungle became one of the most popular attractions in Florida. Here, Butch is giving Churchill a kiss in the most famous of the photos, so famous that Churchill's granddaughter put it on the cover of one of her books, plus it made the bird a star. Butch appeared on the TV show I've Got a Secret in 1955 with young Bill Vander Weyden III, Franz and Louise's grandson. Of course, Butch was the one with the secret, that he'd kissed Winston Churchill. By the way, Butch was female. While the Churchills were on vacation in Miami and were enjoying Parrot Jungle and its birds, at the same time he was writing a speech that would be one of the most important of his life. While resting in the warmth of a South Florida winter, Churchill was about to deliver his Sinews of Peace speech at Westminster College in Fulton, Missouri, in the presence of U.S. President Harry Truman. Better known as the Iron Curtain speech, it's where Churchill coined the phrase, in reference to the developing political boundary that would divide Europe into two areas during the Cold War, approximately from 1945 to 1991. The so-called Iron Curtain was created by the Soviet Union to block itself and its satellite states from open contact with the West and its allied states. Other than Churchill's "We Shall Fight on the Beaches" speech, no other continues to be as historic.
It was, of course, a very big day in the history of Fulton, Missouri, when President Truman and Winston Churchill paid their visit. About 30,000 people had invaded this small Middle Western town, and if we don't see many of them in the street, it's because they were crowding the campus of Westminster College. But what we might call the collection of another degree wasn't the big event this time. It was Churchill's speech, now awaited by about 3,000 people inside, 30,000 outside, and the rest of the world.
He's a great Englishman, but he's half American. And it's one of the great privileges of my lifetime to be able to present to you that great world citizen, Winston Churchill. Nobody knows what Soviet Russia and its communist international organization intends to do in the immediate future. From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. I do not believe that Soviet Russia desires war. From what I have seen of our Russian friends and allies during the war, I am convinced that there is nothing they admire so much as strength.
Winston Churchill had spoken as a private citizen, but it goes without saying that his words carried the full authority of his unrivaled experience as Britain's great war leader. Let us hope they receive the very serious attention they deserve from all quarters.
By the way, Cher contacted the Texas turkey growers and they sent a male turkey to be Winnie's companion. Named Texas Tom, he and Winnie produced several clutches of chicks and were a popular attraction at the park. Tom lived until 1950, while Winnie lived into the 60s, passing away around the same time that Winston Churchill died in 1965. One thing that becomes clear in studying the Chers is that they considered the animals part of the family. They'd take sick ones home to nurse them back to health, and they regularly worked with them, getting them to develop new behaviors. While early on, they bought wild birds from middlemen who got them from people who captured them, in South America, Australia, and New Guinea, for example. As time went on, their birds would mate and raise chicks. The Chers left the process to the birds. They didn't have a breeding program where they chose specific birds to mate. If two birds paired up, they would let them. The Chers provided breeding boxes for birds to use as nests, but that's about it. Just a quick note. Parrots are in an order of birds that have about 400 species in 92 genera. The different genera can only successfully breed within that genera. This means that a parakeet can't mate with a cockatoo, but a blue and yellow macaw can mate with a scarlet macaw. They just produce hybrid chicks. Occasionally, this even happens in the wild. Parrot Jungle's happy birds were very successful producing chicks, so there was always plenty of birds. This allowed them to stop buying wild ones, plus it had another long-lasting effect. As one of the earliest zoos in the U.S. to have large numbers of parrots who were reproducing, they became a resource for other zoos. Not only did zoos send keepers to Miami to learn about parrot care, Parrot Jungle began to loan its birds to zoos. They wouldn't sell them, even hatchlings. Remember, their family. But they were happy to send them to seed, if you will excuse the pun, the collections of various zoos. The most personal connection to another zoo was with Busch Gardens in Tampa. Located about 280 miles or 450 kilometers away, Busch Gardens was established in 1959 when the Anheuser-Busch Company built a brewery on 160 acres or 65 hectares. August Busch Jr., the president of the company, wanted the grounds to include gardens for visitors who'd take the brewery tour. Busch was as much of a showman as an executive, and it was he who instituted the Clydesdale horse-pulled beer wagons that continue to be identified with the company to this day. Busch believed that the gardens would broaden the public's interest in the new facility and product. In the early 50s, Busch would make his first visit to Parrot Jungle. Like Churchill, he was very impressed at both the concept of the attraction and how the Chers developed it and were operating it nearly 20 years after it opened. He would return multiple times over the next few years, learning what he could while becoming friends with Franz. His visits were at least part of the inspiration of how Busch Gardens developed into a bird attraction as well as a landscaped garden. In this 1979 animal guide, it mentions, "Many species of parrots, macaws, and cockatoos have lived and reproduced here since our beginning in 1959. When Busch Gardens opened, they not only adopted many of the innovations that Parrot Jungle had developed, they presented their own shows where talented birds displayed many of the same behaviors, and they even hired several Parrot Jungle employees. One major difference between the two attractions was that the Busch Gardens birds were not allowed to fly free. Parrot Jungle held on to that unique distinction. The two parks were also connected with the loan of many of Parrot Jungle's birds for breeding purposes. Shortly after opening, Busch Gardens would expand, and contemporary news articles mentioned its bird population grew to around 1,000. There's little doubt that the parrots and other birds were extremely important to the park. More than 60 years later, birds of all sorts continue to grace the park, which eventually developed into one of the country's largest zoos, with a highly diverse animal list, as well as one of the world's most popular theme parks. Franz Scher died in 1973, just 4 days short of the 37th anniversary of the opening of his creation. Louise followed 4 years later. Both lived until the age of 83. Their son Jerome would become the manager of the park around the time that attendance had begun to drop and profits were slipping. As I've mentioned in other videos, the opening of Walt Disney World in 1971 radically changed the face of Florida tourism. The Orlando area, which had historically only experienced modest tourist activity, was suddenly vaulted to Florida's top destination. Disney, along with Florida's interstate highways and turnpike, created a challenge to every other attraction. Those that were the most popular were suddenly hoping that Disney's visitors would also visit them. Smaller attractions that relied on people driving by were faring much worse. By the early 1980s, there was a long list of closed attractions throughout the state. Still, Parrot Jungle was a force to be reckoned with. In 1981, the attraction sued a pet shop in New York City that was using the name Parrot Jungle. The result was that the judge made the pet shop stop using the name because it was harming the attraction's reputation. The important part of the lawsuit, at least from a historic point of view, was the Parrot Jungle business profile from 1980. The judge's finding includes the following. Parrot Jungle was created in 1936 by one Franz Scher. It is situated on 12 acres of lush foliaged land and features parrots and other birds uncaged and in a natural habitat, much like a jungle. Parrot Jungle in Miami is a nationally known enterprise which each year attracts some 400,000 visitors who pay $5 per adult admission to view the birds and grounds and to watch a show of trained parrots. Plaintiff's gross revenues from its operations amounted to $3.2 million in 1980. By the way, more proof of Parrot Jungle's importance can be seen with two clips in the opening montage of the hit TV show Miami Vice. Both these flamingos and macaws were from the now iconic Miami institution. The Scher children made the difficult decision to sell the park. There were plenty of offers, even Busch Gardens was seriously interested, but eventually two local businessmen, a veterinarian and a significant bird breeder who had about 1,000 birds at his breeding facility. Both were huge fans of Parrot Jungle. So in 1988, 51 years after opening, the attraction would no longer be owned by the Schers. In 1992, the last of Parrot Jungle's original birds died. It was unknown just how old Marco, a green military macaw, was, but he was at least 60. That same year, Hurricane Andrew hit. The Category 5 storm was the worst to hit Parrot Jungle and Miami in the 20th century. Prior to landfall, the staff rushed to place 1,200 birds and other animals in the concrete bunkers that had been built to keep them safe. When the staff, many of whom had sustained heavy damage to their own homes, returned to the park, they were devastated to see that nearly all the greenery was gone. Andrew had uprooted 150-year-old bald cypresses and destroyed more than half of the park. Happily, the animals were safe. News crews, who were looking for positive and inspiring stories, were able to share the good news of the jungle's animals. Even the flamingos, who couldn't be relocated because they were too high-strung, survived by huddling together next to one of Franz Scher's sturdy rock walls. A few years later, it became obvious that Parrot Jungle would need to leave its home if it were to continue. Today, the area known as Pinecrest is filled with wealthy people who'd rather not have to hear parrots squawking and see tourists driving on their roads. The owners of Parrot Jungle proposed a move to a site on Watson Island, about 14 miles or 22 kilometers to the north. The site is owned by the City of Miami, which approved the deal. The new park, initially named Parrot Jungle Island, has many of the features of the original, but it also includes new ones. Here's a recent map of the park, now it's called simply Jungle Island. While parrots are still important, the attraction presents a more diverse list of animals than ever before. As for the original location, the village of Pinecrest purchased the land and has turned it into a park. It uses the original entrance building and is described as a cultural arts park. As you can see from this map, it maintains some of the spirit of Parrot Jungle while preserving aspects of its storied history. Today, Parrot Jungle's legacy is farther reaching than most people might imagine. Think of the number of descendants of the original birds of Parrot Jungle's first 20 years. Most of them were wild and represented a great variety of genetic diversity. I've tried to see if there was a way to determine just how many birds around the country are direct descendants of Parrot Jungle's collection. The DNA of the birds that the Shares loaned out for 40 years might be in the majority of parrots, cockatoos, and macaws in zoos today. However, it's all but impossible to know for sure. I suppose it's not that important, but I'd love to know. For the most part, legal importation of wild birds ended in the 1970s, so most birds alive today were hatched in captivity in the U.S. This means that Parrot Jungle's genetic legacy will remain significant for many, many generations.
While the attraction named Parrot Jungle is gone, it continues to exist in ways more real than just memories. We're fortunate for that. So many other Florida attractions, including very important ones, have left no physical remains. But today, people can walk the paths of the original park and then go visit the animals, many of which are the great-grandchildren, the ones that Franz Scher and his family showed off on that first tour in 1936. Thanks for watching another of my videos. If you enjoyed it, please hit the like button and subscribe to my channel to learn more about Florida tourism history. Stingray Tom's Florida, traveling through time around the Sunshine State.